This is what's on the agenda. Nope, nope. Aha. Ah, Sandra's got it. So I'm just going to quickly outline what the problem is when it comes to suffering. I think we've all experienced suffering before, but there's a very sort of philosophical and intellectual objection to the problem, which I'll quickly address. And then we're going to go through some philosophical responses and some experiential responses, and we'll have some discussion time in between so that you can have a chat with your neighbor and see how you feel about each of these responses. Cool? All right, so next. So in terms of outlining what the problem is, the theologian Michael L. Peterson framed the problem in this way. So he says, something is dreadfully wrong with our world. An earthquake kills hundreds in Peru. Pancreatic cancer patient suffers prolonged excruciating pain and dies. A pit bull attacks a two-year-old child, angrily ripping his flesh and killing him. Countless multitudes suffer the ravages of war in Somalia. A crazed cult leader pushes 85 people to their deaths in Waco, Texas. Millions starve and die in North Korea as famine ravages the land. Horrible things of all kinds happen in our worlds, and that has been the story since the dawn of civilization. The fact is, there is indeed evil in the world, and there is indeed suffering in the world, and it presents a very legitimate problem for the Christian worldview. The Christian claim actually faces a logical problem in the face of the reality of suffering. Get the next one. So the Christian claim, I believe, is that there are three parts to it that are all very, very important. So part one, God is all-powerful. I think that we would all agree on that. Two, God is all-loving, or God is good. And three, evil is a reality. Now, I don't think any of us here would want to deny any of these claims, but they are all quite difficult to hold together. Especially, I mean, I think one and two are especially central and essential to the Christian faith, which leads to us having to deal with point number three. How do we sort of consolidate this into our faith? The Scottish philosopher David Hume puts it this way, and you might have seen this objection before. But I think it's probably the most eloquently put. He says, if God is willing to prevent evil, but not able, then he is not all-powerful. If God is willing to prevent evil, but not willing, then he is not good. If God is willing and able, then why do evil and suffering exist? And this is a really, really challenging question. This is, as you can see, it's a purely logical standpoint to take. It makes a lot of sense from his perspective. And so today, hopefully, we'll be dealing with some of these responses. Just on the next slide, I've got just a little table here. And as you can see, there is no problem with evil and suffering if God is not all-powerful or if God is not good. It's only when we have God is good and all-powerful do we face the problem of suffering. And that's in that top left-hand corner there. So as I take you on this, I suppose, journey, through some of the theodicies, some of the responses to suffering. Just the next slide, please. I just want you to think about these four questions for each of them. How wide is the response? How accessible is it? How is it relatable? If you share this with your friends, do you think that they would accept this as a reasonable answer? What are its strengths? What does it cover? What are its limitations? And how useful do you think it is? And I'll cover each of them. There will be a time to discuss each of them, but please try and keep these questions in mind as I'm going through them. So I'm going to try and use a little bit of film and TV references to explain each of these theodicies, trying to make it a little bit more fun. So I'm not bombarding you with just philosophical and intellectual questions and information. So the first one we're going to come to is called the free will defense. And I'm drawing from a popular sitcom that was aired on NBC a few years ago called Great News. Has anyone seen it? No one's seen it. Oh, one person. Yes. Yes. So this is a picture from one of the episodes of Great News. I apologize. It's a little bit grainy in terms of the quality. But as you can see from the image, we have a very cute couple here, clearly very much in love, enjoying each other's company. you can see from the caption, you know, they're having a low-key date night, and she's sort of celebrating her relationship with this with her husband here. But what if I were to tell you, the next slide, what you see there is that she's holding a knife handle, and the blade has been photoshopped out. So she is holding a knife to his neck, taking this photo. How would you feel then about this relationship? How would you still say that they're enjoying each other's company? Would you still say that they're very much in love? Would you still say that he's there because he wants to be there? I think you would definitely question that. I think you would say, this marriage has got problems if you have to hold a knife to your husband's neck in order to take this pretty photo so that you can have 500 likes on Instagram. And this is essentially what the free will defense, in a very crude sense, is about. It's a very crude illustration, but the man in this picture is only there because he has that knife being held to his neck. He's not exactly there of his own free will. He doesn't really have a choice, not any real choice anyway. In legal terms, anyone who's under duress or under threat, especially when under contract law, if you're under duress or threat and you sign a contract, that contract can be rendered void. It's not considered a real contract if you had to sign it under threat. And likewise, you know, you can't really say that he's expressing his free will. You can't really say he's expressing his love, definitely, if he's under threat, if he has a knife held to his neck. And similarly, you know, if I created a robot that every day I came home, I opened the door, there was a sensor that triggered, and the robot said, I love you, you can't really call that love. Like, that's just automation. That's not an emotion. There's nothing meaningful about that. That's something that I forced that robot to do. And likewise, what the free will defense says is that if God has created us without free will, if God created us as automatons that were forced to love him, that would not be any kind of real love. That would be completely meaningless. But because he's chosen us to create us with free will, he's given us the capacity to choose and therefore given us the capacity to love him. Love without that choice is completely meaningless. And in order for us to experience and express love in the truest sense, we have to have the freedom of choice. However, as much as it is possible for God to do anything, because he is all-powerful, it's impossible for God to create creatures that have free will that only choose good. That's a logically incoherent position to take. It's kind of like God cannot make a spherical cube. It just doesn't, it doesn't make any sense in our minds for that to happen. So the free will defense says, you know, free will must mean that humans are free to choose against God. They are free to hurt and harm each other and free to do evil. And this is supported, I suppose, by the Garden of Eden narrative in Genesis 3. Adam and Eve were free to do whatever they wanted, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil existed because God had to give them the option of disobedience in order for them to be completely free. If that option for disobedience didn't exist, then there was no real choice for Adam and Eve to make to be obedient. So this is made quite famous by a Christian philosopher called Alvin Plantinga, but this is the free will defense to explain why there's evil and suffering in this world. We are free creatures. We are free to choose against God, and therefore some human beings will choose to cause each other suffering, to cause evil, and therefore that's why evil exists. So I don't know, I'll give you 30 seconds to think about how wide do you think this is, how accessible you think this is, whether you like it, whether you don't like it, and whether you'd be willing to share this with your friends. You can chat to your neighbor if you'd like. We'll just bring it back in now. We'll have more time to discuss in depth a little bit later, but it's good to sort of share your initial thoughts as I'm running through these. All right, so I'm going to present our next theodicy, or theory of why suffering exists, and this is called soul-making. It's actually been quite popular since the early patristics of the church. Now, to explain this, I'm going to draw on the 2015 Disney Pixar film Inside Out. Who's seen Inside Out? Okay, yes. Great. Who hasn't seen Inside Out? Ah, oh, what a shame. We've got to see it. It's a great film. So Inside Out, just to briefly recap what it's a little about. So it's set inside the mind of a young girl. I think she's like 12 or 13. And her name is Riley. And in her mind, there are five personified emotions represented by the characters on the poster. So there's joy, disgust, sadness, anger, and fear. And they're sort of personified into made into little human characters almost. And then they lead Riley through life in her brain as her parents try to adjust moving from Minnesota to San Francisco. So I am about to show you a scene where, if you go to the previous slide, sorry, Sandra, where Joy is looking at one of Riley's most treasured memories, where it's a memory of her teammates of her ice hockey team called the Prairie Dogs, and they come to lift her up and celebrate her after a playoff game. And Joy comes to a realization about the significance of sadness. I think you've got to click on the... Yeah. We've got sound.
It was the day the Prairie Dogs lost the big playoff game. Riley missed the winning shot. She felt awful. She wanted to quit.
Dad, the team, they came to help because of sadness.
All right. So once again, that's a slightly more simplified version of what the soul-making theodicy is about. Essentially, you know, through Riley's sadness, she was able to experience true joy. It's out of that sadness that she has one of her fondest memories, her teammates, her parents coming together and celebrating her successes, even though they lost that playoff game. So the soul-making theodicy is the claim made that not all suffering is inherently evil or inherently bad. There can be positive outcomes to suffering. So evil and suffering are required for human beings so that when we go through trials and tribulations, it helps to essentially form our souls, develop us into characters that are more similar to Christ. We were on a journey to becoming more Christ-like, and suffering is simply a part of that. Now, as I just mentioned, there are certain experiences of joy that are greater when you have overcome suffering, and therefore, not all suffering is necessarily evil. There is a redemptive quality to it. And of course, eventually good will overcome evil. God will redeem suffering and bring order out of chaos at the end, and that's the story of the cross. But the scripture that really supports this is Matthew 16, where Jesus talks about whoever wants to follow me must pick up their cross, and who wants to save their life will lose it, and whoever loses their life for my sake will find it. So, that's the soul-making theodicy, and I'll give you another minute or so to think about whether or not you like this one, what its strengths and limitations are. Go ahead. All right, we'll slowly start to wrap it up, and we'll move on to the last theodicy that I have for you of the philosophical kind. So this one, I must admit, is quite difficult to wrap your head around. I was having a discussion with Laura about this yesterday, and it is a little bit philosophical, a little bit intellectual, but I will try to explain it as best I can using film. Has anyone seen the 2013 rom-com, About Time? One, two, That's three. Okay, cool. I actually haven't seen it, admittedly. This is a film. This is often referenced by my colleagues at the OCCA to explain this particular theodicy. And I do think reading the synopsis, it's quite effective. So once again, About Time, released in 2013, tells a story about a man whose name is Tim, who he has found that he has the ability, the men in his family have the ability to travel back in time to any point in his life, but not before his life and not forward past the present. And he's discouraged from amassing fame and fortune by his father, but so he instead uses this power to improve his love life, which is a great premise for a rom-com. And so he gets married, he settles down, and he has a daughter. But at some point in the film, Tim's sister gets into a car crash, and he decides to use his time travel powers to prevent it from happening. But when he does, he returns to the present, and he finds that his daughter was never born. But instead, he has a son. And so he's completely distraught. He obviously loved his daughter very much, was there at her birth, and then now goes forward in time and has found that changing the past has changed the future. He no longer has a daughter, but he has a son. So he decides to go back in time and allow his sister to be in that car crash, and his moving back into the present, his daughter returns to him, but he allows that suffering so his daughter can exist. Now, in a similar sense, if we were to go back in time and erase every instance of suffering right from the very beginning, what would the world look like now, is the question. The non-identity theodicy essentially asks, what are you asking for when you ask for a world without suffering? And so if we removed all suffering, if we had a world without plate tectonics that allow for life but also cause earthquakes, or a world with a slightly different set of the laws of physics, or a world where God intervened at every moment that someone got hurt, like just before you were about to stub your toe, God moves the object out of the way. It's very plausible that if we had, if that was the case, and we existed in a world where all suffering was removed, no one in this room would exist. For example, my father, he's from Malaysia, and he went through a difficult time in high school. He failed his, I don't know what you call it, but his final exams to get into university. A-levels, thank you. So he did terribly on those due to some horrible family circumstances. But as a result, he went to Singapore to study at a local institution there, and there he met my mother. And if he did not have gone, if he had not gone through that suffering, and had not failed his exams, I wouldn't exist. And so, would it have been better for my dad to have never experienced suffering? That would be saying, it would have been better for me not to exist, which is a very difficult thing to ask and a very, very difficult thing to say. But just as Tim was distraught about his daughter ceasing to exist, God chooses not to intervene at every instance of suffering because he doesn't want just any group of people. He wants us. He wants you. And God values you. God values the people you love, the people sitting next to you, not because you're better or smarter or better looking, but just because he values human beings. And instead of scrapping the whole entire universe and changing it when the first instance of suffering appeared and when we broke the system, he allowed it to continue because he values the people in it and their decisions. But God still provides a way to redeem us from our suffering, and he's given us the opportunity to be in relationship with him, and through him, we can still have eternal life. Now, I know that's one's a little bit harder to wrap your head around, but I'll give you another minute or so to discuss that. Oh, actually, why don't you discuss all three? I'll give you 5 minutes to discuss all three. These are a summary of the three, and I want you to think about what you think the limitations are, what the strengths are, how useful you think they are, and how accessible you think they are. And then I'd like to get your feedback, but I'll give you 5 minutes to the 12 past the hour. Cool. Discuss with your neighbor, please. Just got a minute left, so let's just start wrapping up your conversations, please. All right, cool. If we could just come back in. I'd like to get a bit of your feedback as to what you think of each of these particular theodicies, each of these responses to the question of suffering. So free will defense. Who here likes the free will defense? Okay. Yeah, all right, about a third of the room. Anyone dislike it, and if they dislike it, why do you dislike it? Anyone feel like there are limitations? Yes. Yes. Yeah. There's definitely a difficulty with generational sort of bondage. Obviously, just even statistically, it's more likely for children of smokers to be smokers and so on and so on. And that's a well-known fact. So, that is a good point. Yes, please.
I don't like it because it doesn't say anything to me about natural disasters.
Yep. Yes. Definitely, yeah. So, I mean, you may be able to attribute some natural disasters, perhaps, to climate change, but definitely, I mean, like, plate tectonics has nothing to do with climate change, for example, so earthquakes, tsunamis, that's kind of left out of it. That's definitely one limitation. Anyone else? Ah, sorry, she said that it doesn't, the free will defense doesn't say anything about natural disasters, which is true, or sickness as well. You know, it's essentially, I mean, to ascribe human responsibility to sickness is a little bit of a, it can be, it's a bit difficult. So anyone else? Sorry?
That's the point, it's not that all suffering does not flow from evil. If you, right. The natural disaster
right.
example, yeah.
Yes. I think as well, I mean, for those of you who may subscribe to such a view, but the free will defense doesn't work with a sort of a Calvinistic approach either, because that's quite determined. Okay, soul making. Who likes soul making? Oh, fewer people. Okay. Who doesn't like soul making, and for what reason? Should we have that? Ah, yep. Go ahead.
Yep. When somebody dies, there's no. They don't experience the development of their identity any further.
That's true. Yeah. Yes, there's one up the back there. Sorry, Johan.
It makes God seem like a bit of a sadist.
Right. Yeah, it can. I think that's an important question. You know, does God purpose suffering or does God allot suffering to us? And I don't know if that's what the soul-making theodicy is saying. I think it's saying suffering happens, but God uses that and redeems it and turns it into something good. So there is a bit of a distinction there, but please, go ahead.
Yeah, I think the question is, can there be suffering without evil? So is that necessarily connected? And if suffering is sort of used for soul-making or character building,
mm-hmm.
Maybe if there would not be evil, so we would still be in paradise, then maybe something else would be introduced by God if suffering is needed for
right.
character building.
Yes.
Then, you know, how would we mature?
Yes.
Is that solely by, you know, by God's love?
Right.
Or something else we, yeah.
Yes. So is suffering truly necessary to learn a lesson or experience joy? Like, couldn't I not be visited supernaturally by God while I'm on a beach in Spain and learn a lesson that I may have there instead of going through a tough time and trials and tribulations? Perhaps. I mean, he is all-powerful after all. Last one?
I observe, the soul-making one works well for small problems.
Yeah.
It refines us, but when you come to big ones,
it's a bit insensitive sometimes.
It's
kind of like, you know, your right. friend's going through a tough time, and then you go, oh, everything happens for a reason. You know, it's not comforting. It can be a little insensitive. All right, the last one, non-identity. Who likes this one? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. And who doesn't like it and why?
It's just too theoretical.
Too theoretical was the objection. Yeah, it's not very accessible, and I admit, it's difficult. Even for us who have been trained in the OCCA, find this one sometimes a bit hard to wrap your head around. There is one big limitation to all three. Oh, sorry, please.
Maybe you're about to say this, but I didn't raise my hand for liking or disliking any of them because I think they all have good points, but they all have their downsides.
Absolutely.
And I think at the end of the day, part of the problem is we have little brains and God is a big, big God. And what we're trying to do is describe the indescribable, yeah?
Okay.
And obviously this is where faith comes in, and
yeah.
which is different than yeah, theology and doctrine and things. But the other thing that I think is missing in all three of them is the concept of blessing being God's attention and not good things. Mm-hmm. I think we conflate that. We think blessing is good stuff,
yep.
But actually blessing is God's attention.
Yep.
And I don't think any of them take that into account.
Yeah, okay, great. The one big limitation I personally see to the three is that none of them really speak to the human experience very well. And this is a line that one of our professors, Dr. John Lennox, would say. He said, cancer looks very different to an oncologist than it does to a young mother told that she has 6 months left to live. If someone comes up to you and says, oh, how can a God exist if suffering, a good and loving God exists if suffering exists? That may be an intellectual question. But if someone comes and asks, my mother died when I was young and she wasn't a Christian, does that mean she's going to hell? That is also a suffering question. And if you gave an answer like this, I don't think you would score any points for that person. I don't think you'd be doing them any favors. So the second half of this presentation, I want to quickly go through because I realize I don't have that much time left, are some responses, some more experiential responses that we can give. The first one is the response from morality. So it's essentially the asking the question of what is the nature of suffering? Can we ascribe a moral value to it? And if we can, or if we do, why are we able to do that? Essentially, if we are to take God out of the picture, is suffering still bad? Or is suffering still wrong? Now, the very famous atheist scientist, Richard Dawkins, says, in a universe of electrons and selfish genes, blind physical forces and genetic replication, some people are going to get hurt, other people are going to get lucky, and you won't find any rhyme or reason to it, nor any justice. The universe that we observe has precisely the properties we should expect if there is, at bottom, no design, no purpose, no evil, no good, nothing but pitiless indifference. And what Dawkins is saying here is that the world has always been a cruel place. In fact, it's cruelty that has enabled the world to have human beings and have the species that it has today. Since suffering has always been a part of life, there is nothing good or evil about it. It just is. So just deal with it, is essentially what he's saying. And so if there is no God, there is nothing wrong with evil and suffering. However, when we think of evil and suffering in our own lives, or in a global sense, we intuitively, instinctively think that it is morally wrong. There is something unjust about the oppression of people in slavery, or there's something unjust about famine, or there's something unjust about natural disasters taking thousands of lives. Why do we get a sense of injustice in the face of suffering? And as an Oxford student, I have an obligation to quote C.S. Lewis. So C.S. Lewis says, my argument against God was that the universe seems so cruel and unjust, but how had I got this idea of just and unjust? A man doesn't call a line crooked unless he has some idea of a straight line. What was I comparing this universe to when I called it unjust? Essentially, the argument for morality is that if God doesn't exist, then suffering is not a problem. Rather, it's just a natural part of things, and it's just the way things go. However, we feel a sense of injustice when we face suffering. We intuitively feel and think that suffering is wrong. And that intuitive belief points to a transcendent being. It points to a transcendent morality, and our sense of injustice points that there is indeed a God. So I'll give you 30 seconds to think about this one because we're running short on time. What do we think? We just bring it back in again. And I've got one final one to discuss, and then you'll be free from my voice. Cool. So the response from the cross. I don't have any literature or film to draw upon for this one, but I do have an anecdote. So for this, so one of my classmates at Oxford was sharing her experience of her father's passing in January last year. And it was obviously a very difficult time for her and her family. And she was telling me, I'm really thankful for all the people who texted me and called me during that time of grief. But now when I look back, the people I'm the most grateful for are the people who came over to my house and sat with me and sat with my family every single day. And sometimes we'd share stories and we'd reminisce and we'd laugh and we'd cry, but sometimes it would just be silent and there was nothing to say, but their presence there was so helpful. And this, in essence, is also the response from the cross. So Christ came and suffered on the cross, and when we suffer, he suffers alongside us. The German theologian Jürgen Moltmann said that when we feel pain, we participate in his pain, and when we grieve, we share his grief. People who believe in God, who suffer with us, recognize their suffering in God, and God in their suffering. Essentially, Christianity is the only religion that claims that God came down to earth and suffered with us. So Jesus' suffering on the cross means that he understands your suffering, and when you are suffering, he is suffering right there with you. He knows and understands it, and he cares. You know, Jesus himself suffered pain, he suffered loss, he suffered anxiety, he suffered dysphoria, amongst many other things, and his death and resurrection mean that one day, evil and suffering will be overcome, and it will no longer exist. You know, in Revelation 21:4, it says, he will wipe every tear from their eyes, there will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things have passed away. Now, I just want to quickly say, if anyone here is going through a time of suffering, I want to assure you that God does indeed care, and he cares for you, and Christ came to take that all away. And there will come a day that there is no suffering anymore, and that's what we're hopeful for, and that's what we're joyous about. But the team, after the session is over, the team here would like to, you know, if you are going through that, would like to pray with you over in the corner as it was last night. But that will come a little bit later. I just want to, once again, just finally give you another couple of minutes to discuss, and then Laura is going to join me up, and we'll do a little bit of Q&A as well. So please, go ahead. I just want to make a few final points on this particular topic. It was supposed to be a sort of a practical session. And so it's just a few pieces of advice that we've learned through our studies in Oxford this last sort of 12 months. The large majority of objections to Christianity stem from a place of suffering, but they're often masked by other things. So questions of sexuality, questions about hell, questions about free will, questions about bioethics, almost every objection has an element to suffering in it. And as much as you know, we can sort of intellectualize away the question and use lots of different theodicies and philosophies to answer the question, what's most important is that we engage with the person and not just with the question. As I was saying before, you know, to present the soul-making theodicy to someone who's truly suffering can be a little bit insensitive. And this is why I feel the response from the cross that was up there before, you know, really speaks to human experience. When people are truly in suffering, they want someone to suffer alongside them, someone to be alongside them. So one of the key pieces of advice we get is don't lose the questioner by answering the question. And I think that's critically important, especially in the topic of suffering. But I'm happy to take your questions now. Laura will be joining me as well. So does anyone have any questions or comments about what was covered? Oh, yes, please.
I've just asked Laura. I just was saying I still don't get the whole natural disasters and, you know, terrible diseases that are caused by, you know, genetic inheritance, let's say. Because, you know, when 20,000 people are wiped out in Nepal on an earthquake or any of these other terrible things that happen, we get that. I think I get that God is weeping there with us, but why does it happen? Because it's not through sin that suffering is taking place.
Yeah, I want to just one comment about that. There are some Christians that believe, you know, the tsunami, you know, in 2008, I know the big one that hit Southeast Asia. Oh, people go, oh, you know, the Thai and Indonesian people were such sinful people with their debauchery and their sexual sin and stuff, and that's why that happened to them. That's not true. That's not biblical at all. And that's not what God ever wants or desires. He never wants to just wipe out swathes of people.
The biblical story of Bartimaeus is really useful here, where the blind man sitting on the street and people come... people come by and say, oh, is this person blind because of his sin or maybe the sin of his parents, that it's an inherited disease? that somehow he deserves because he was born to a sinful family or he himself has sinned. And the way Jesus responds is, I believe, a response that we should learn and internalize to give our friends. And it's one that says, no, this person has not done nothing in his life that has made him deserve this disease. And then he goes on to heal Bartimaeus. When it comes to like the wider question of disease and also natural disasters, I zoom back to what happens in Eden, in the garden, and to the fall. So sadly, our sins are not reduced and limited to just us. We're in a web of social interactions, and our sin always affects the people around us. So we heard earlier, there's the comment that, but like the person, the child of certain parents who have sinned, they will have more baggage, if you want to use that term. Or it definitely always affects us, what also the generation before us did. And so it's not always limited. Sin is not always limited to us. And therefore, we also have to be aware that our sin will always affect the people around us. And when it comes to natural disasters, it's just the general fallenness of the world. That means that things happen that aren't good. But knowing that in that, God has come to restore and to heal.
It's a little bit Okay, yeah. we'll chat with you afterwards about that as well, but we'll take this.
But that's what I said about the Bartimaeus story. It's not for that reason, but I would say it's like the general fallenness of the world, why those bigger scale things happen. So sin doesn't only affect us humans, it also has an effect on nature. The biblical view of the world is much more integrated, and so our sin doesn't only affect us and the person next to us, but actually also affects the land, and the land is cursed. And that is what would explain natural disasters that affect us negatively.
Is climate change not a product of sin?
Oh, yes. So there's an element of neglect of stewardship, and then there's just general fallenness that are intermeshed.
Okay. Second question would be... Hello, you.
Sorry.
Is a cue.
We've got to move on so we can get a few more questions, but thank you. I do appreciate it.
It's okay. I just wonder if you could differentiate evil from badness in an apologetic sense, because we've used the word evil, but we've never actually positioned it. And... whenever I do this lesson in school, there's always a differentiation to make, perhaps. And I'd be interested to know how you would do that as Oka people.
Yeah, I think when we discuss evil, at least my understanding of the term evil, we tend to refer to that as a human experience. Like when you see that a tree has fallen, we don't go, oh, what a great evil that has occurred to this tree. But when people suffer, we feel like that there's an element of evil to that. And I think that speaks to, in a sense, we value human beings, and we believe that human beings have intrinsic value as Christians, but also as non-Christians. We tend to, even the secular society will say that human beings have value. But where we ascribe that to, and why we feel that when humans suffer, that is evil, once again, I think also just speaks to a transcendent being. But I would differentiate the point of badness. You know, a gazelle gets chased down by a lion and is eaten. That sucks for the gazelle, but that I wouldn't consider that evil. I don't know if you would agree, Laura.
I would. When it comes to morality or, I don't know, educating children, I don't know if I'd make that huge of a distinction between evil and badness. Different theologians and different schools, like, Christian streams will maybe categorize sin in like bad and then worse. I think, especially if we want to strive towards holiness, I think it's all sin and we all need to address it equally. So when it comes to just a natural way of things in our world, I think that is not evil. I would characterize that differently. I don't know if I'd even call it a badness or a necessary evil, but there's a natural cycle to things. And then you could go into the debate of, was there a certain natural death in Eden as well? And that's a whole theological debate that we can have later if you want to.
Yeah, but I realize that we are keeping you between... we are in between you and lunch.
Yeah.
Do you want to take the final question? Yeah, final question, and then we'll go.
Yeah, I just wanted to add something, because I agree with you that the consequences of what Adam and Eve did is much more than just that death and disease came into the world. But also in Romans 8, it says very beautifully that nature itself is longing with eager... eagerness to be liberated from its tendency to decay.
Mm. Yeah.
And also, I just almost made a sort of a joke with Barbara that I don't think an earthquake would have happened in the original Garden of Eden. And also there were promises to Israel that if they followed their God and that they would be spared and they would be blessed and there would be peace, but they didn't do that, so evil did happen to them. Mm. I don't think we can point the finger to particular nations or anything, but just as a general spiritual rule, yes, that the whole earth and nature itself is decaying. And
Cool.
Thanks.
Okay. On that note, once again, the prayer corner will be open.
So I don't know if you have a ministry time now or later, probably, rather. But when I was praying for this conference and I knew that Don was going to speak on suffering, I just had it on my heart to share that at conferences like this, we have a great opportunity to open up about different things that are in our lives. And when it comes to the topic of suffering, we often attribute it to the world out there. But I know from experience that there's also a lot of suffering and evil that happens in the church that causes us to get bitter and so on, and let evil root in our heart. And I just want to encourage you, it was at a conference like this that I opened up about that hurt with people, and that was the start of a breakthrough. And I just want to encourage you to go for prayer ministry, if that is you, and to open up about this here so that you can start into a new working year having dealt with that pain and that suffering.
Cool.
And also, Don and I will be around if you have further questions, and we'll discuss something further. If there's something like a story, something deeper, we're happy to chat with you and pray with you as well.
Come sit with us for lunch, and if you have any questions, we'll be around. But you are free.